Thank you. Wow.
Yeah.
I couldn't even get an interview for the
Oh, wow.
They didn't like it.
No,
no, better than that.
Yes,
Thank you.
Good afternoon. My name is Tom Guernsey. I'm President and Dean of Albany Law School, and I'd like to welcome you to the 16th annual Kate Stoneman Day here at Albany Law School. I'd like to extend a warm personal welcome and appreciation to our speaker today, Professor Annette Gordon-Reed. We are especially privileged also to have with us many esteemed members of the legal community, both the bench and the bar. For those of you who are new to Kate Stoneman Day, this event honors the significant contributions of women in the law and is named for the first woman to graduate from Albany Law School, Catherine Stoneman, class of 1898. Kate Stoneman challenged the law of her day and became the first woman admitted to practice law in the state of New York in 1886. And as many of you may know, we are so proud of the fact that Kate was inducted into the National Women's Hall of Fame in Seneca Falls this past October, and I had the distinct pleasure of accepting the award on her behalf. The Kate Stoneman program is an important part of the Albany Law School experience in which we continue to learn and celebrate the contributions of those who advance women in the legal profession, and I want to thank you all for joining us this afternoon. At this time, it's my great pleasure to introduce Minnie Netter from the class of 1972 and one of the founders of Kate Stoneman Day and its first fundraising effort. Minnie?
Thank you. Thank you, Dean Guernsey. On behalf of the Stoneman Committee, I too welcome you all.
Speak in the mic.
Pardon?
Thank you. I said I too welcome you all on behalf of the Stoneman Committee. Truly, I'm honored to be your host for this year's Kate Stoneman program. Tonight, three women will join our existing group of Kate Stoneman Award recipients, bringing to 57 the total number of very special individuals honored since the program's inception in 1994. I would ask that all past Stoneman Award recipients who are with us tonight please stand and be recognized. And I do have regrets from several who are unable to be with us. And I also acknowledge all who helped to make our Kate Stoneman program a reality, including my fellow members of the Kate Stoneman Day Committee. They're listed in your program, and we all faithfully meet. We thank as well the Albany Law School Women's Law Caucus, co-chaired by Joey Cush and Christina Tripoli. Thank you all. Now, this year's Kate Stoneman program is unique because we have a very special guest with us. For the first time in our 16 years of KS events, we have with us a direct descendant of Kate Stoneman herself. She is Fran Florio, whose great-grandmother was Kate's niece. How did this all come about after 14 years of all the Stoneman publicity at ALS? Well, last February, we were contacted by a woman searching the web for some information on a member of her mother's family, and she was surprised and delighted to find a book published in her name, Pioneering Women Lawyers from Kate Stoneman to the Present. And that was edited by Patty Salkin and published by the ABA. The email went on to say, Aunt Kate was always a role model for me as she was to other members of the family. In her will, which is Fran possesses a copy of it, she left her estate carefully divided among her nine nieces and nephews. And to her niece, Julia Stoneman, my great-grandmother, she left a number of personal items. One of the items that Julia inherited is a purple silk dress dating from the 1880s. It's in very good shape and demonstrates that Kate was a small woman, the princess, much smaller than me. Fran, would you please stand up and wave to the audience so we all see who you are? So nice to have you here.
Taller than
me. Okay, that's
Maybe we can all speak to you, if you'd like to speak more with Fran afterwards in the reception down in the foyer. She can give us some more information about the history of this family and her incredible relative. The reason we're here, I mean, think about it, a person's legacy. And okay, I stuck that in, so I kind of lost my place. Fran traveled from Randolph, New Jersey to join us. She has generously donated this dress, among other memorabilia. This was worn by Kate in the 1880s, and we are most grateful to you, Fran, and I do look forward to speaking with you myself to find out more information, having trailed down people knowing Kate Stoneman over the years. And now Paul Finkelman, Albany Law School's President William McKinley Distinguished Professor of Law and Public Policy, will introduce our honored guest, who is someone who is a friend of Paul's, known for many years, I guess. And Paul, where are you? Here you are.
Thank you very much, Mimi. And it's really, as a historian, it's always wonderful to actually deal with an artifact of the past rather than simply words and ideas. It makes us feel a little bit closer to our world and also gives us, I think, all a sense of the power of the closeness of history, particularly in this country. That is, that we can see and even touch, I suppose, if we're careful, something that is that old and yet in some ways that close to the United States. I've known Annette for a very long time. We were trying to figure out how long we've known each other. We were both at Harvard Law School together. She assures me that I would have known her only because she was one of the two black women in the class. But that was just in our section. I think they had two in each class, for each section. My PhD advisor who went there said that when he was there, it was like Noah's Ark. They had two blacks in the English department, two blacks in the history department, two blacks in political science, two in the law school. But in any event, since that time, Annette and I have traveled the lecture circuit, been at conferences, most recently spent two terrific years as participants in a workshop at Yale University on slavery and law. When I went to graduate school to study history, people knew that during Thomas Jefferson's second run for the presidency, second successful run, there had been rumors of his liaisons with one of his slaves, Sally Hemings. But the general historical profession, which up until very recently was entirely dominated by white men, never thought much of this relationship. Most of the time, they simply said it didn't occur, it couldn't have happened. And this situation was also, of course, supported by what became the Jefferson establishment. That is a large number of people centered at a small village in Virginia who spent most of their time defending the memory of Thomas Jefferson. I once gave a paper at Charlottesville on Jefferson and slavery, and I suggested that it seemed pretty obvious that Thomas Jefferson had had children with Sally Hemings. And I was simply told that Mr. Jefferson wouldn't have done such a thing. And I'm not sure what it was, the thing that Mr. Jefferson wouldn't have done. Later, a scholar wrote a book about Jefferson in which he referred to him as the American Sphinx. And in the process of trying to defend Jefferson from the suggestion that he would have had a relationship with his slave, Joseph Ellis went so far as to suggest that Jefferson was too effeminate to have relationships with Sally Hemings. I always thought that was a kind of an odd position for someone to be taking, that, well, we will defend Jefferson on these grounds because it's better than the alternative. I always took these statements about Jefferson quite seriously because, if nothing else, one only needed to look at the timing of the children that Sally Hemings had and the times of which Jefferson was back in Virginia and add 9 months and you somehow got a child. And it seemed to me that, there was a certain kind of mathematical certainty here, but there was no proof. Today we have proof in two ways. One is we have proof in terms of DNA evidence, which overwhelmingly suggests that Thomas Jefferson was the father of Sally Hemings' children, although there is a slight possibility that this could have occurred from one of Jefferson's uncles. But this seems unlikely. More importantly, we have the work of Annette Gordon, who took the issue of Thomas Jefferson and Sally Hemings more seriously than any other scholar has ever done, and wrote first a book about Thomas Jefferson and Sally Hemings in American Controversy in 1997. And at that point, I thought, well, that's the end of it, she said it all. Only to discover 11 years later, in 2008, that she wrote a spectacular book, one that has won the Pulitzer Prize, one that has won a number of other prizes, probably from the perspective of scholars even more important than the Pulitzer Prize. It won the Frederick Douglass Prize, which is a prize where you have a jury entirely made up of very serious scholars. The Pulitzer Prize juries tend to be political. They are often involving journalists. The Douglass Prize is a prize committee of scholars, and the scholarly community has rightly said that this was the best book of the year, not only in American history, but also in the history of African Americans. If there were a Kate Stoneman Prize for the best book in gender history, it might very well have won that prize as well. And maybe there ought to be such a prize if we could only get somebody to donate the money to fund it. Intent. But all of this comes out of the work of a remarkable woman. Annette went to law school, became a lawyer, is now a law professor, practiced law for a while. But all the time that she was doing that, she was doing this very, very serious history. And what I mean by serious history, it's the kind of history where she got her hands very dirty. She got her hands into archives. She read old letters, old manuscripts, the things that when we go to a conference and someone like Annette presents her work to lawyers, the first thing they ask is, well, what Westlaw database did you find all this in? And of course the answer is you don't find this stuff in Westlaw databases. You find it by doing the very hard archival work that she's done. It's really an incredible honor and a privilege to introduce my good friend Annette.
Exaggerating. There were more than two blacks. We had a pretty good number of people in the law school. But Paul and I have sort of met on the circuit of historical conferences and law professor conferences, and it's always good. It's always good to be able to spend time with him. And now I'm actually on his home turf. I don't think I've been anywhere where it's actually your home. So this is actually this is quite good. This has been an amazing year in lots of ways. I'm deeply honored to receive this award, and Paul is right. It's wonderful to have something from history so close and actually have a person who is connected to someone in history. And I've had the experience of doing that quite a bit with the Hemingses, because over the course of the time that I've been working on this subject, I've met a number of members of the family, and it's an interesting experience. It's good because you get a connection to the past. It's not so good sometimes because you have to do what you have to do regardless of what they want you to do in terms of telling their story. And so you have to be close and detached at the same time. But to have an artifact and have a person that connects you to a person that we're all here to honor is a wonderful thing. And I'm glad that we coincided at this time to be here when you are here, when they discovered you and you discovered them in a way. So it's very, very fortunate for me to be here. As I said, this has been an amazing year in lots of ways. Somebody told me back in 1994 when I first started working on this subject, working on it seriously, I've been thinking about it a number of years, but thinking about it and writing about it seriously, that I would still be talking about this in 2010. I said, you're crazy. I knew people were interested in the subject. I was a little bit taken aback by the reception to my first book that Paul referred to, Thomas Jefferson and Sally Hemings in American Controversy, which was basically a look at the historiography. It was not a narrative, but looking at the historiography of the way historians had written about this story about Thomas Jefferson and Sally Hemings, not because the idea that a slave owner had children with an enslaved woman was a big deal. It's actually a banal thing. It was something that happened quite a bit. And interestingly enough, history and science are coinciding now to tell us pretty much how prevalent it was. They're going along now using Y chromosome technology, DNA testing, and have determined that in some communities, upwards of almost 47-48% of African American males have European Y male chromosomes. So that doesn't even account for women, or because women don't have Y chromosomes, or slave owners who had sons who then had daughters, and so the male line is cut off because of the daughters. So we're talking about a huge percentage of people, and this didn't happen in the age of Obama. This didn't happen recently. This is something that happened in slavery, and there was all kind of mixing that was going on during that time period, and it wasn't just the overseer. It wasn't just the people in town. The way the story was is that Southern gentlemen didn't do this kind of thing. It was always somewhat of a lower class. Well, the Y chromosome testing has pulled out lots of families. They pulled out the Jeffersons. They pulled out the Carr family, another prominent family in Virginia. I believe they pulled out the Lees. I think the Lee family has done Y chromosome DNA testing in their people. So this is a phenomenon that occurred all across the South, all across social classes. And so the idea that, you know, Jefferson would have had a child with an enslaved woman, for someone who grew up in Texas and who understood about slavery, and anybody who's been to a black family reunion knows that black families are all different colors of the rainbow. So the notion of mixing is something that we, I think, blacks are confronted with every single day, children who are different colors. Parents and you know, in different mothers and fathers in different colors, their children different colors. So this is something that we live with. And so it doesn't seem like a startling thing. And it didn't seem like a startling thing to me then. What I really wanted to write about was the way in which the words of African American people, enslaved people, were heard in the pages of history. We've come a long way in writing about slavery, and Paul has been a wonderful part of that, and has helped this process along. But there's something about the founding generation, writing about Jefferson and Washington and those guys, that sort of eluded the transformation, the sort of development. We're sort of stuck in a time warp. And so people really were, into the 90s, now there's a bit of revisionism going on now, in the sense that people say, well, you know, people weren't making a big deal about this. Lots of people accepted this, but it was really a handful of people who accepted the story. And again, it was not about the actual thing, you know, whether he had children. It was how people were receiving the words of the man who said that he was the son of Thomas Jefferson and Sally Hemings, a man named Madison Hemings, another enslaved man named Israel Jefferson, whose real name was Israel Gillette. I thought, you know, this is odd. You have this institution that everybody sees as an oppressive institution and an institution that victimized people, and you pay attention to the people who are victimizing them, not the people who suffered under the oppression. And that struck me as the world turned upside down, and that, you know, a burden of proof, your notions of who you believe, those are policy questions. It's not 2 + 2. It's a political decision to decide to whom you're going to give the benefit of the doubt. And it struck me as odd that slaveholders would be given the benefit of the doubt, whereas slaves would be treated as the people who were untrustworthy about what happened to them. And it was, as I said, topsy-turvy. So that's why I wrote the first book. I wrote the second book, and I got the idea of doing it while I was working on the first book, because it occurred to me that people didn't know very much about the Hemingses. And what they knew about the Hemings family, the only person they focused on was Sally Hemings. And so I had this crazy idea at first that I wasn't going to write about her in the second book, which is obviously ridiculous. But I thought, okay, just a minimal amount of Sally. And Sally and Tom, I'm going to write about all these other interesting people. And then, of course, that was crazy because she's the linchpin of all of this, this story. This is why her connection to Jefferson is why the family is remembered and is known. The name is known because of her. So after I got over the initial reticence, my Sally problem, I was able to start working and actually get into the archives, do the kinds of thing that Paul was talking about, to actually try to do something else. The first book really was to talk about historiography. This book was to try as best as I could to bring this family of people alive as much as I could. I think that enslaved people, and to a degree black people, are very often seen as a monolith. There is an enslaved person, a slave girl, a slave boy. And because slavery was racially based, there's a tendency to do that with blacks as well. I even think today, if you watch television or any kind of movie, there are types of black people. There are types of white people too. White people get stereotyped as well, but I think blacks get stereotyped even more. You know what the black woman is going to say, how she's going to say it. The black guy, everybody is a stock character. My children said once, my daughter was watching sort of a marathon of a show called Scrubs one weekend, and then she was watching another show, I've forgotten what it was, but the other one was a drama. And she said, you know, the black characters in those shows, even though they're different shows, are constant. And that's the phrase that she used, constant. They're not really, they don't change very much. And as I said, white is a stereotype too, but it's a wider range of things. You see a wider range of types of people portrayed than you typically see with black people. So what I wanted to try to do here, as much as I possibly could, was to talk about enslaved people as individuals. That's a somewhat touchy and for some people subject because slavery was such an enormous tragedy and such an enormous thing that people, there might be the suggestion, well, why focus in on an individual when you're faced with the magnitude of something like that? But I think it's exactly the opposite. I think that there's a time to focus on individuals. You can show the horror of an institution, the problems of an institution, if you get people to focus in on the individual people who are living it, and not just see them as a monolith, a group of people over here, this thing happening to them, but actually put a name to people. So I set about to do that, to talk about Sally Hemings, which lots of people know about, Elizabeth Hemings, her mother, who is the matriarch of the family, her sisters, her brothers, to see them as individual people living under the institution of slavery, living a somewhat different life, because for people who know the story, or if you've heard anything about the story, you will know that Sally Hemings was the half-sister of Jefferson's wife. So because of that relationship, they had a very, very different connection to Jefferson than other people on the mountain. So it really doesn't do any good to talk about them in relationship to the other people who were enslaved there. Because he separated them out. The men, Sally Hemings' brothers, hired themselves out and kept their money. They traveled around. Lots of times, he didn't even know where they were as they were off doing various things. That's a very different, they're enslaved, but that's a very different experience. And if you think about someone who is able to go off and work on their own, make their own money, that has to do something to that person's inner life. Now, I don't have their letters. Robert Hemings and James Hemings, they were illiterate, but all of Jefferson's letters to and from Robert Hemings are missing, so we don't have those. But I can tell what happened to them, to give you a sense of, to ask the reader to think about what it meant to have those kinds of experiences. I end the book talking about the Fawcett family, which is also a member of the Hemings family. It was Elizabeth Hemings' grandson, Joseph Fawcett, who's freed in Jefferson's will, but his wife and his children are not freed. So even right there, you've been following along with the story of Joseph Fawcett through the book, and you come to the end, and you realize he is free, but it's like a classic dilemma. His wife isn't free, his children aren't free, and he asks members of the community to purchase his children. And he promises that when he saves his money, he will buy them back. Just think about that. I mean, what it would be like to be in a situation, number one, where your children are up on an auction block, an 11-year-old, whatever age, up on an auction block. You have to bargain with people to buy your children back. Some members of the Hemings family who were freed bought some of the children and gave them to Joseph Fawcett. But the other ones he had to bargain for. Two of his daughters were taken out of the state, and we don't know what happened to them. The youngest son, Peter, who was auctioned off when he was 11, the man who purchased him reneged on the deal and refused to sell him back to his parents. So they stayed in Virginia for as long as they could, and trying to persuade him to change his mind, and then they finally move out to Cincinnati, Ohio. And there's something, a small happy ending with this, because Joseph Fawcett and his son Peter and his wife were reunited when Peter buys his freedom as an adult. He moves out to Cincinnati, and he becomes a minister and a caterer. And this is why we know this story, because when he dies, there are two large obituaries of him in Cincinnati newspapers that talk about his life and what he had done after he had come out of slavery. So asking readers to follow along with a family, with those types of things happening, there are many other stories that I could tell about what happened in the book, is a way, I think, of bringing them alive to people today. Because you can see, it's hard, at least it is for me, and I don't think it's just because I'm African American. I think it's a human thing, if you read the stories, to think about what it would be like to be in that situation, to have your children parceled out, to have a family that is constantly in threat of being sold and separated. Beatings, those kinds of things, that's definitely a part of slavery as well. But consistently, over and over again, when slave people talk about what they feared the most, it's the separation from family. What every one of us in this room would feel being in that type of situation. So it was my privilege, all the great things that have happened to me this year, so many things that I haven't even really had a chance to actually let it sink in yet. It's my privilege to be able to bring this family story to people, because I called it an American family, because I really wanted to emphasize that this is an American story. It's the story of African Americans in this country that we really, really don't think about as we think about slavery as this overwhelming institution, which it was, but to bring it down to the personal, bring it down to individual people so that we can make that kind of connection. And I'm really happy that Paul and people here have thought that this was something that was worthy of your honor and would, in fact, fit in with honoring the life of a woman who was a pioneer in her own way, just unimaginable kind of thing, situation to be in. Even you think, we women today complain about, we sort of feel slighted in some ways in law schools and in legal profession, and we're still fighting, but to imagine one person alone doing something like that is tremendous courage. And so I'm really, really happy to be able to link the story of the Hemingses to Kate Stoneman's story today here with you, Albany. Thank you very much.
The others who never were found again, and the families and what happened to them. I hope someone options this for a film. Have they talked about it at all?
Well, they have, but I'm leaving that to other people. Option it, but don't make it.
All right, now you get some awards.
Oh,
for your record of extraordinary achievements, commitments to the ideals of Kate Stoneman, we're honored to present you with the 2010 Albany Law School Kate Stoneman Award, and we have yours right here, plus a gorgeous roll too. This is it. This is it. Thank you. And you also, you do get a bowl also.
Oh.
Yes.
I do not want a thing to happen to us.
Unless you want us to fill it with scotch.
I'll be part of that. All right. Thank you again. I'm going to think about this all night. To present the first of the two additional Kate Stoneman Awards beside our principal speaker is Krupa Shah, class of 2010, a student mentored by Barbara Cottrell, our next recipient.
Good evening, everyone. I'm Krupa Shah, and I'm currently a third-year student at Albany Law School. Last year, I had the privilege of interning with the U.S. Attorney's Office. During my interview for the position was the first time that I encountered Ms. Barbara Cottrell. She intrigued me from the first time I met her. She asked inquisitive questions, and her extensive knowledge was amazing. But little did I know that this unassuming woman would come to be an incredible mentor and role model. It was during this year-long experience at the U.S. Attorney's Office that I was fully able to realize what lies beneath that humble woman who first interviewed me in jeans and a sweater. I've interned and worked at several places throughout my career, but I've never met a mentor like Ms. Cottrell. For instance, I remember working on one of my first projects. Ms. Cottrell came in and she asked me to write a motion to dismiss. 2 weeks later, I submitted my final draft for her review. I figured she would read it and she'd take the relevant portions in what she was working on. But I was immediately caught off guard. And why was that? Because when I came in the following Monday, not only had she reviewed my motion to dismiss, but she had also wanted to set up a meeting to discuss any changes that she wanted to make to my motion. During that meeting, Ms. Cottrell and I discussed any changes that she wanted to make. Not only did she didn't take the changes and automatically apply them to my motion, but she sat there and asked me my questions and why I approached it the way that I did. We had an hour-long discussion, and that just truly amazed me, because knowing all that she does, that she took that hour out just to sit with me and make sure that I learned in what I was doing. After leaving a position, it is often very difficult to keep in touch with those that you work with, but it feels as though my relationship with Ms. Cottrell has not changed. For instance, I remember last semester, it was right before finals, and I had just gotten out of class. It was 7 p.m., and it was a Thursday evening. I was just trying to get ready and work on some outlines when I walked through the East Foyer and ran into Ms. Cottrell for a reception. The first thing that she asked me was, "Have you heard yet?" A month prior, I told Ms. Cottrell that I was going in for a second interview for a position that I had really wanted. And I couldn't believe it that with everything else going on in her life, that she still remembered. I was just one of the many students that she had taught and worked with in her 20 years at Albany Law School. And when I say that Ms. Cottrell does many things, by no means am I exaggerating. Ms. Cottrell served 3 years in the Army Medical Service and the 44th Medical Brigade Headquarters. She then transferred to the Army Reserve to attend law school, while also interning at the U.S. Attorney's Office. Ms. Cottrell then served at the 36th General Hospital until retirement, achieving the rank of major. Currently, Ms. Cottrell is the Appellate Division Chief at the U.S. Attorney's Office for the Northern District of New York. And she spends any free time, and I tell you, she has very little, but she spends it on the Board of Trustees for the law school while also serving as an adjunct professor. In addition, Ms. Cottrell also spends time at the Colony Youth Program to make sure that young individuals are deterred from any criminal behavior at a young age. For her tireless efforts in empowering women and inspiration to those students who hope to follow in her footsteps, I'm absolutely thrilled to present the 2010 Kate Stoneman Award to Barbara Cottrell.
Thank you.
I don't know how to follow that glowing introduction, but I will do my very best. I am absolutely honored, thrilled, overcome at the award, at the nomination, at Krupa's reception of my criticism and support. I am delighted to see a number of my law students, past and present, in the audience tonight, and each of you has been very special to me, and I thank you all very much for being here. I was fortunate during my time in law school to have been nurtured by many faculty members, by Dean Bartlett, by many of my professors, Professor Frank Anderson, who was my faculty advisor, Professor Gottlieb, who I believe is here in the audience tonight, the late Professor Watkins. They all nurtured me through my time at Albany Law School, and I committed myself upon graduation to doing what I could do to pass that along to other students and help nurture them as well. I seem to have had some success at it. I'm gratified at that success. I thank my friends and colleagues who are present today to share in this momentous occasion with me. And I particularly want to acknowledge and thank my mom, Norma Jane Cottrell, who had... the opportunity to attend law school, as two of her daughters have now done, both Albany grads, she would have set the world on its ear in legal profession, as she has done in the rest of her life and through the works of her four daughters. So thank you all very much for this award. I hope to continue having an impact on students, and I hope that the students that I have touched pass that on and have an impact on others. Thank you very much.
We'll come back for this and help everybody with these beautiful bowls. That was really wonderful. And what a great tribute to your mom. As two sisters going through. That's fantastic. But we hear great things about you, what you've done with students, and are very proud of that. Now, to present the final of today's three Kate Stoneman Awards is Albany Law School's own Professor Deborah Mann, who herself received the Albany Law School 2009 Distinguished Educator for Excellence in Teaching Award. Debbie?
Well, good afternoon, good evening. What an incredible event these Kate Stoneman days are. And it's sheer joy on my part to introduce Dale Skivington to you, our next 2010 Kate Stoneman recipient. Dale and I have been best friends since we were law students at Albany Law School. In fact, it was Dale and I and our husband, Peter. And Dale and I graduated from Albany Law School in 1979, as did her husband, Peter. Dale has been a trailblazer, a leader, a mentor, a teacher, and a supporter of women throughout her illustrious legal career, and it's my opportunity to share with you some of her legal career famous points. Dale has practiced law at Eastman Kodak Company for over 20 years, and she is currently, and I do need to look at my notes because you have to listen to this title, she's currently the Assistant General Counsel and Vice President and Director of International and Employment Law Legal Staff. And in that position currently, she is the primary attorney for all human resources related matters, and she oversees all of the international lawyers for Kodak. Okay. Dale is also the former chief privacy officer for Kodak. She is an expert in the field of privacy law and was among the very first individuals to hold the title of chief privacy officer in corporate America. And she was Kodak's first. As chief privacy officer, she designed, developed, and managed Kodak's global privacy infrastructure, including security policies, with regard to the stuff that's out there about us, with regard to personal data relating to Kodak's customers, employees, and vendors. IBM, Microsoft, and Kodak were among the first corporations to see the need to develop these privacy policies and to name chief privacy officers in their corporations. Dale's career at Kodak has allowed her to travel the world in her various capacities, being in charge of all the international lawyers. Very good gig. As a result, as her best friend since law school, I have benefited. Dale has lived in some very beautiful places. I will long have memories of Christmas week in Berkhamsted, England, outside of London. David, perhaps you've been there. And I have fond memories of the local publisher of the local newspaper inviting us into his house. Of course, we were in a pub at the time. And he felt so sorry for us, these expatriates who were over in London area in the week of Christmas. And as we left his house, we'll never forget the blackbirds singing in the deep of night. It was a Beatles moment. Dale has also worked in, and I'll pronounce it the way I used to pronounce it, Geneva, Switzerland. No, Geneva, Switzerland, where she managed the human resource functions for all of the EU countries and the Middle East for Kodak. Her work has also taken her to China and to Australia and to South America, among other places. Dale's legal work includes her work in labor law, labor relations, employment law, alternative dispute resolution, and privacy law. She was chosen to be the management sponsor for the Women's Forum of Kodak Employees. That's an employee network formed to assist women employees to achieve their full potential. She has worked to expand the opportunities for women throughout her legal career. She has mentored younger women attorneys inside and outside of Kodak. And here's a little secret. Dale often, as an in-house counsel, needs to retain outside counsel. And it's a known fact that Dale will look and search out for a woman attorney in a law firm she's hiring to talk to so that the woman attorney gets credit for getting Kodak. She's good people. Prior to her work at Kodak, Dale Skivington worked in the private practice in Rochester. She was an assistant attorney general at the New York State Attorney General's office in Rochester while I was in the office in Albany. She has worked tirelessly for women's rights, the rights of the poor, and to foster diversity. She is a former president of the Legal Aid Society. She was a member of the New York State Task Force on Sexual Harassment and the Monroe County Task Force on the Legal Needs of the Poor. Dale has been active in organizations dedicated to advancing women in the legal profession, including the National Association of Women Attorneys and the New York State Women's Bar Association and the Greater Rochester Association of Women Attorneys. She was also an early supporter of the Women's Health Partnership, an organization focusing on obtaining health screening for economically disadvantaged women. And she is currently also the secretary for the Rochester City Ballet. A complete career. Dale's legal career and experience have also made her a very popular speaker, and she's lectured extensively on privacy in American business, employment law, and civil rights. In planning for today's presentation, I was discussing Dale's coming to the law school with my esteemed colleagues, Professor Gothic, who is the Associate Dean for Research and Scholarship, and the Governor George E. Pataki Professor of International Commercial Law. And James told me some very positive things about the Eastman Kodak Company in terms of its international law and its activities, particularly in South Africa. And these are James's words. Eastman Kodak withdrew from South Africa in November 1986 to protest the continuation of the policy of racial discrimination against the black majority by the then ruling white minority government. At the time, Eastman Kodak had a 50% share of the market for film in South Africa and 10% of the market for cameras. Eastman Kodak was also one of the few American corporations that invested in South Africa and that signed what's known as the Sullivan Principles that established corporate accountability and responsibility for ethical investing. James told me that Eastman Kodak only returned to South Africa in 1994. After President Mandela had been released from prison and after open, free, and fair elections given the black majority had been announced. Now, Dale wasn't at Kodak when they backed out of South Africa. But I point this out because I do believe that individuals can and do make a difference in their legal careers, and that if you find the right place to work, wonderful things can and do happen. When Dale joined Kodak in 1988, and since then, she has had a vibrant and stimulating career and has had many opportunities to work to enhance the opportunities of others. And by the way, with all this history today, I did some history research myself. My colleague, Paul Finkelman, I couldn't come up here without having some history. I'll remind you that in 1886, Kate Stoneman became the first woman admitted to practice law in New York. 2 years later, in 1888, George Eastman of Eastman Kodak introduced the world to the first simple camera using the slogan, "You press the button, we do the rest." And in 1898, 10 years later, Kate Stoneman was the first female graduate of Albany Law School. Yes, she had already been a lawyer for 12 years, but that's not time for another story. Dale has continued the trailblazing work of Kate Stoneman, her daughter Emma, who is graduating from law school, the Denver Strum School of Law, will also continue that this year, as will her son, who is also graduating from college from Richmond. He will continue on. I know their family is very happy. Her mother, Beverly, who's a very well-known Shaker High School teacher. She's now retired. She's in the room. And I do know that the Donald, and I don't mean that one, the Donald, is looking at you tonight and is very happy. And her sister, Jerry, is also in the room. Her husband just had hip surgery and couldn't join her. But I know that her other family friends who are here are going to join her. And it is sheer joy on my part to give you the 2010 Kate Stoneman Award.
Such fantastic women. And I was reflecting on what this award means to me. And what it occurred to me was that given the mentors that I've had in my career and in my life, my path, my chosen avocation, which is fostering the careers of women, was predestined. My grandmother, Sally, was an accountant and worked until she was into her late 70s as a bookkeeper for her three brothers who were lawyers, some of whom went to Albany Law School. My mother also was a full-time career person, having graduated from SUNY Albany and Columbia University, and taught my sister and I and my brother that anything was possible. Thank you, Mom. My first boss was Margaretta Powers, another Kate Stoneman Award winner who established one of the first female law firms in upstate New York. And our sole client at the time that I worked for Powers and Gandy was to represent the ACLU in civil rights actions. And it was at that point I became an employment lawyer working with the office of Powers and Gandy. I then was fortunate enough to have such amazing peers, such as your award-winning Professor Mann, my current peers at the Eastman Kodak Company General Counsel's office, including the General Counsel, Joyce Haig, who wanted to be here today but was unable to come because she's ill. But she has an incredible leadership team, which is predominantly women, and she has a focus on diversity and a commitment to it like no other General Counsel out there. My husband would have loved to have been here today. He's my biggest supporter. He allowed me to pursue a career that was somewhat controversial. I left my family twice to go abroad for Eastman Kodak Company. But I think what he recognized is something that another Pulitzer Prize author has said, which is well-behaved women seldom make history. So for allowing me to misbehave, Peter, thank you very much. And for Albany Law School for launching my career and giving me the opportunity of a lifetime, I thank you. I thank the law school for its commitment to women. Some of its new initiatives that it's kicking off in terms of supporting women are absolutely fantastic, and I look forward to continuing to be involved in them. Thank you.
If you would all join me in just one complete round of applause for these incredible Kate Stoneman. I even want to know where Barbara got her shoes, but those are the deep things that I think about. Each year, I continue to be blown away about the people who we honor here and what accomplished women they are. And we get awed and we get inspired at the difference in the women we've had as Kate Stoneman recipients and speakers to us. I wish that every single woman and man in the school would come to these programs, especially young people, people starting in law school, and see the diversity of what happens. A law career is just such a great beginning for so much. In the coming months, you'll be hearing about the law school's efforts to increase, what else? Financial support for scholarships in order to attract bright, accomplished students in this highly competitive environment. We believe that what Kate Stoneman accomplished in carrying the bill through the New York State Legislature that allowed women to be admitted to the practice of law in New York State should be memorialized in many ways. Remember, every time, I can't give up on Stoneman, we had the chair, which actually Donna Wardlaw and Diane Phillips did after I got organized the funding to endow the day, and then Gail Brown and our group got together to get a nice stone for Kate Stoneman's grave. We went down and had our own private ceremony doing that. Well, now it's going to be, I have the privilege of announcing, a new specific effort. It's going to be a scholarship in Kate's name. So when you are asked, I don't know, if I just think it's so important that she has become so known that a relative can go on the internet and find out what we have done in the book about Kate and all the speeches of people who came before published in that. So when you are asked, I'm sure you will be, please contribute as generally as possible because your gift will make a difference for the law school and deserving students and will help to serve to strengthen the Kate Stoneman legacy at Albany Law School. This is concluding our program. On behalf of Dean Guernsey and the Kate Stoneman Committee and the Albany Law School Caucus, I want to thank you all for attending and ask you to join us down in the foyer for whatever food may be left there for the students.